Welcome back. Right, so these are like kind of two important basic computations. And now we actually, in the rest of today's lectures, we actually want to talk more about condensed DB in groups. So right now we were somehow considering cohomology of condensed sets. Now we somehow want to go to condensed DB in groups. And we want to understand some X between some. So let's compute X between natural examples. And I mean, what are some natural examples? I mean, you want basically, you certainly want ZR, R mod Z, but you might also consider, say, a product of R mod Zs, or I don't know, a ZP, I don't know. So, I mean, the most basic ones, maybe you want the Adels, that we want to consider right now are locally compact DB in groups. Yeah. So how does this look like? So in this, so some of there you have discrete guys, in there you have compact guys, and in there you have R vector spaces. And in some precise sense, everything is now built from these examples. And then there's an important operation on this Pontryagin duality. This would actually swap the dual, the discrete, and the compact guys. It would induce a self-equivalence of the R vector spaces. So what is Pontryagin duality? That's just forms into the circle group into R mod Z. And any compact DB in group is just the homes from some discrete DB in group into R mod Z, conversely. And so locally compact DB in groups, because they are compactly generated, they actually embed into condensed DB in groups for the first one. And so we will always consider them in this way as condensed DB in groups. And so here's some theorem, which might let me try to remember what's the best way to state it is. So there are some base cases that you really need to prove, and I forget what the base cases are.
I think the best way to state it is that there are no higher X, and the X one is just the extensions of locally compact abelian groups, right?
Right. Okay. So right. For AB, that we call this LCA, locally compact abelian. Well, the home from A to B is the usual home. That's just follows because of this fully faithful embedding. And these are some other cons in groups. This is also the X1 in locally compact B in groups from A to B. And the XI. Zero for I bigger than. And so, for example, If A is a product of armored, sorry, product over some possibly infinite index set. It's happening. If A is a right, X1 means classifying strict short exact sequences. Yeah. So also, I mean, these are the ones that somehow become exact and condense to being groups. So that's another nice thing about the condenser being groups is that, somewhat, it is in a being category and it comes with its own notion of exactness already. And in examples, it just already implicitly recovers all the strictness hypotheses you want to put in. You don't have to put them in by hand.
In the last line of the theorem, it should say I greater than one.
Yes, of course. It should say,
in a Boolean category, I may have missed some of yesterday. Could I ask?
Yes, so this is an abelian category.
Cracked abelian category, these condensed abelian groups, they're Grothendieck abelian category?
Yes, I mean, they're Grothendieck abelian except for that they don't have a set of generators, but just a class of generators, but that doesn't matter at all.
And they have enough projectives.
With enough projectives.
Projectives,
With enough, I mean, even compact projectives.
And its dimension is one, homological dimension is one. Is what you're
no,
saying now.
No, only locally compact to be in.
The subcategory.
I mean, we already saw that there can be higher X because if I go back to the very beginning of my lecture, sorry for sliding all this stuff. Here we were looking at these cohomology groups of X with coefficients in M. Right, and we saw these are the usual sheaf cohomology groups of a compact Hausdorff space, which can sit in as many degrees as you want. And that's also an X group in this category of condenser being groups. So this means that you can have X groups all over the place. If A is R mod Z, do they exist non-trivial injective condenser being groups? Great question. No, but that's a purely set theoretic issue. So if you are in kappa condenser being groups for any kappa, then this has enough injectives because it's a topos, and in a topos you always have enough injectives. And you even have enough points in this topos. It's just that these are horrendously inexplicit. But in condenser being groups, there's actually no non-zero injective condenser being group. So somehow they don't stay injective as you go up the tower. They would need to get larger and larger and larger as you go up this tower. I wrote up a proof on mass overflow somewhere. If A is a product of R mod Z's, then the R hom from A into R is actually identically zero. So that's a nice theorem because, I mean, if you can never try to map something compact into something like the real vector space because the image would, on the one hand, have to be bounded, on the other hand, stable under addition, and then some of the two things together force a contradiction. And in fact, there are even no X groups. And the other thing is that the R hom from A into some M, where this is discrete. You can actually compute it, and it's concentrated in degree one, and it's an infinite direct sum over I of M sitting in degree. So what does this mean? This means that there are no maps from A to M, and that's because this is connected and something is discrete, well, it's totally disconnected, so there can be no maps from something connected to this M. But of course, there can be lots of extensions of this A by discrete things, because somehow you have this quotient by Z's here, and so using the Z's here, you can actually easily get the map from here to here, producing extensions. And then the claim is that this, these kind of obvious classes in here that you have, that they are actually everything. All right. And it actually turns out, if you think about it, I mean, if you use kind of obvious exact sequences relating some are building all locally compact abelian groups from these three examples. You can actually show that these basic computations imply the rest of the theorem. All right, so the task is to compute these things here. So you want to compute the R-Hom from such a compact abelian group into some other guys. And so the way I've stated this here is that actually the targets here are actually the two examples we already previously considered. So we computed the cohomology with coefficients in something discrete and with coefficients in some in the reals. So that's actually also why I did those two cases. But now we want the R-Hom from some compact abelian group. So what we know so far. Is the R-Hom from some Diojohn X into either M or R for X compact Hausdorff. Right, because this was just the R gamma context of X with coefficients in Eisenman. And so if we can resolve our A, which is, well, A itself is compact Hausdorff, but it's not the free abelian group on a compact Hausdorff space, but it has a group structure itself on this given compact Hausdorff space. But if we could resolve this A by such guys, then we could use the result we already have here and hopefully get some mileage out of this. So we need to do something. And so we need a resolution of A of the following form. So what we can always do is we can always resolve any group by the free abelian group on the underlying set. The free abelian sheaf on the underlying, this is a free condensed abelian group on this condensed set. So we have this rejection and this is of this form where we know it, so that's good. What are the relations here? I mean, so here are some of the class of A maps to A. But we somehow didn't enforce that A plus B goes to A plus B. And so we still need to enforce that, but we can do that if we take Diojohn A squared here and map the class of the pair A comma B to the class of A plus B minus A minus B. Okay, and then if you sit down for long enough, you will realize that you can write down the surjection here from some Z-adjoint A cubed plus Z-adjoint A squared, given by some explicit map, so that it will generate the kernel of this. And then if you sit down for even longer, you can maybe realize that you can again write down something explicit here. But nobody has been able to write down some explicit infinite complex doing this. Okay. So, but there's a theorem that goes back to Breen and then was proved in, I mean, Breen proved something closely related, but not quite this in its strongest form. Deligne proved it, but never published it. It says the following. There is a functorial resolution. And the key is really functorial of an abelian group A of the form. Let me call this a star. So by functoriality, somehow any such map from some C adjoint A squared to some G adjoint A must be given by some kind of universal formula taking a pair A comma B to some such formula here. Right, so basically the claim is that there is a resolution where each term is just a finite direct sum of terms of the form the free abelian group on some power of A. And all the maps are given by some universal formulas like this, and it's somehow always exact. There's a direct sum, oh, I don't know, from I, j equal to 1 to some n I, c to some a to r I. J. So each term is a finite direct sum of free abelian groups on finite powers of A. The problem with this resolution is that it's really not explicit. And so you might think that's not good for computations, because if you don't have an explicit complex, then how are you ever going to compute something? But turns out it's actually good enough to just know the existence of such a resolution. Okay. How is this proved? I maybe don't want to prove it.
Pardon, does this have a more modern interpretation, infinity categorical or operatic categorical, like 20th century interpretation?
21st or 20th?
21st, yes, it's 21st. Yes, sorry.
Good question. So the proof of this actually involves a little bit of stable homotopy theory. But I'm not aware of some, like, I don't know.
Can you say anything about the exponents, the NIs and the RIJs? Like, are they polynomially bounded or anything? Or
probably, yeah. Okay. So I mean, one can give some more or less explicit construction of this. So the thing is, there is some kind of first approximation to this, which is some of the bar resolution of just a group, but it doesn't quite do the right thing, because you're somehow resolving abelian groups here, not just the groups. And then you can do iterate the bar construction, then something becomes more and more commutative, except only becomes more and more commutative up to homotopy. And so then there's some kind of version of this where you, instead of really abelian groups, if you replace abelian groups here by spectra, and you somehow replace the free Z module on something by the free spectrum, so some suspension spectrum, then you can actually write down something explicit in terms of iterated bar constructions. And then there's still this difference between the sphere spectrum and the integers, but this is somehow only bounded torsion by finiteness of stable homotopy groups of spheres, and then you can somehow massage it afterwards a little bit. But this final step is somehow not really explicit. And yeah. So it feels like there is some kind of infinity categorical stuff behind this, but I don't think there is something operatic behind it, though. I mean, you definitely have this other resolution where you somehow you take Z adjoint A and then you somehow just continue with the same trick, and then somehow take the free guy on the free guy and so on. You have this operatic resolution, but this operatic resolution is not so useful because in the second step, you get this free.
It's kind of infinite, right? Too infinite.
It's too infinite because these guys, they are not compact Hausdorff anymore in our case, right? So there is just some large guy then. And this is not really helpful. You really want to be able to control the things that are free on. And uh, Yeah, so I think I will not give the proof of this for lack of time. And so proof season notes. I mean, this condensed.pdf on another page. So I already basically said as much as I wanted to say. So there is a version of this using the iterated bar construction that would give something explicit with the sphere spectrum, and then you modify it a little bit. What's great is that because it is completely functorial, it actually automatically extends to any topos or to condensed abelian groups and so on. Functoriality. Extends to any topos and to condensed. So we get a resolution. Yes, decide. So yeah, we are interested in this. We are interested in these R arms here from this A, and we have some resolution of this form. And for all the terms, we already know the answer. We can compute this R arm here, and then the task is to really now understand what this complex amounts to. And because the complex is not really explicit, you might think that you're not in good shape, but we know enough about the complex to conclude. So here's a proof of the theorem in LCAs. So the step one is actually the following, that the R hom from R into M zero if M is discrete. So why is that? So we have R, and this is resolved by C join R, C join S, and so on. And we know what the cohomology of So the cohomology of any R to the N is coefficients in M. We know that this is a sheaf cohomology, but this R to the N is a contractible space, right? So we know, I mean, it's a CW complex, it's a contractible CW complex. So we know that this is actually just M in degree zero, and zero if I is positive. And so so if we write down the spectral sequence corresponding to this resolution, then we actually completely understand all the terms in this sequence, except that in degree zero, we still get something. And a priori, it might this might cause problems, but then we do something completely stupid. We also use this resolution for the zero group. Right? And so, on cohomology, this induces a restriction map from just some of the origin, zero to the N in M. And of course, this is also M if is equal to zero. And zero if I is bigger than zero. So this is an isomorphism. And so if I call this map here alpha, so alpha upper star from the R hom from R to N, the R hom from the zero group to N. This is a quasi isomorphism because on all the terms in the resolution, all these term maps induce quasi isomorphisms because there we just get these cohomology groups. That's quasi isomorphism. Okay, but maps from the zero group, we can compute that at zero. And yeah, so the trick here is that although this resolution is not explicit, and so we don't actually know what we would get if we just do the R hom from R into M here, and then we still get some inexplicit complex, but it's the same inexplicit complex as for the zero group. And then we win. So then there is some small translation. So now we can also compute the R home from R mod Z into M. And this is M in degree minus one. And for this, you just use the sequence zero maps to Z R mod Z maps to zero. And if you take the R home into M here, then for R, we just computed that we get nothing at all. Well, for Z into M, we just, of course, get M. And then if you think about where it appears as an X1. And so it's the M degree minus one. All right. Then the next step is to generalize this and really compute the product. Maps on the product of an R mod Z's into M. You want to see that this is a direct sum. of M's in degree minus one. And now we even know what the map is because for any element in I, well, this has a corresponding projection map. And so by step one, we can just take the direct sums of the maps from one. From step two. Oops. Okay, and so why is that? So we again use this resolution, use this Brindelian resolution. I should say the following. Equivalently, the R-home the equivalent statement is to say that for any, I mean, you have all the maps to the finite finite products, and it's a co-filtered limit of the corresponding finite products. And then we want to see that if we take the R home from this co-filtered limit, then we can pull this out and get a filtered co-limit over all the finite subsets. Because I mean, these finite products, they are the same as finite direct sums, and then homing out of finite direct sum, of course, you just get a finite direct product or a finite direct sum again, which gives you these. So this thing is just a direct sum over J's. This is just a direct sum over J's of M degree minus one. And then, of course, if you take the filter co-limit over all finite J's, then you get the direct sum here. All right, so we need to see that R homes out of compact abelian groups, they take co-filtered limits into filtered co-limits. If we map into something discrete. Okay, and so for this, you use the Brindelian resolution. Okay. And then if you compute this R home here, you get some on both sides complexes computing in terms of those. And then just like in this argument here, it's actually somehow enough to show that on each of these transition maps, some of the same thing happens. So thus it suffices that R home from Z to some product of I's properties to some R into N is a similar filtered column of a finite subset J. But okay, so what do we have here? So this is just the some of the condensed R gamma on this product over I of R mod Z to the R. Okay. This is the colimit over J I of the condensed R gamma. It's a product over J to the R. This is map. But now we identified this condensed cohomology group here with sheaf cohomology or with Cech cohomology. And then for Cech cohomology, we had the statement, I had the statement at the end of my lecture yesterday that this takes such co-filtered limits of compact Hausdorff spaces here to filtered colimits. So this is nice morphism for Cech. And so, yeah, so this gives this result. And so again, the resolution stayed completely inexplicit, but we didn't actually have to know anything explicit about the resolution. It was enough to have just some resolution of that form. I really like this argument. I think it's a really funny argument. And okay, so we proved this part here, that the maps into something discrete. What remains to do is the maps into the reals. So. And actually, this holds for any compact. And so, using the Breen-Dehlin resolution. We can compute it in some sense. This is computed by, you have again resolution here. And we computed the R home from these three guys because this was just a condensed cohomology of A, and we know that this is concentrated in degree zero. So this is computed by zero maps to the continuous functions from A into R. Continuous functions from a squared into R, and then the next term resolution would be the thing with a squared and a cubed. Okay, and so this map here, so take some function f to function f tilde, which takes a b. F of A plus B minus F of A minus B. And so, I mean, you can write down the first few differentials, but in particular, you can see that there's no kernel here because, well, the kernel would exactly be the additive maps from the compact Abelian group into the reals, but there cannot be additive maps because the image would have to be bounded because it is compact. But on the other hand, this image must be stable under scaling by integers because it's stable under addition. But there are no compact subsets of the reals, non-zero compact subsets of the reals, stable under addition. So it's easy enough to show that the kernel here is trivial, but then afterwards it gets a little tricky, not last because it is actually an inexplicit resolution. So it seems that we're a little bit screwed here without further input about how this resolution looks like, but then can actually just prove a tiny bit more about the resolution, not making it explicit at all, but some further property of this resolution. Use further property. This is the following proposition. That for any choice, of a functorial Brindle resolution, so let me call this C of A, looking to A, to the bullet of A. The maps map to P. So there are two ways to resolve multiplication by two on A. Well, because it's a complex of abelian groups, you can just resolve multiplication by A by multiplying by two everywhere. So you have to map two from C dot of A to C dot of A. And you have the map, I'll call it bracket of two. This is multiplication by two. On the other hand, you can use that the resolution is functorial in A. In particular, the multiplication by two on A induces, like by functoriality in A, an endomorphism of this complex as well. So induced by multiplication by two on A. Our homotopic. Why a functorial homotopy? Okay. Actually, this follows from the proof of the existence of the Brindle-Lean resolution, if you think about it. Or, well, we set up a little bit of machinery to somehow encode the existence of such a Brindle-Lean resolution. And in this world, somehow what actually happens is that there's a certain object in some category encoding this functor that takes any abelian group A to A itself. And this functor admits a projective resolution. And this projective resolution will then exactly be such a functorial Brindle-Lean resolution. And then this proposition here simply follows from the usual statement that if you have projective resolutions of some objects, then any two choices of lifts of the map of your objects to the complex level or to the projective resolutions, any two choices are homotopic. So the difference between those two maps, like on the first term of the, on the C adjoint A here. So on one hand, you send A to 2A, but then you subtract when you do it internally twice A. But that's exactly the differential of this element A comma A, or minus it, I don't know. I'm not sure, I don't normalize it. And so there is some of this homotopy that that in the first spot is given by this map that takes an element A here and maps it to the pair A, A. Okay. And so how does this help us? Consider this complex. So this means that the identity on this complex is homotopic to, well, the identity I can think of this as a half times two. It's homotopic to a half times bracket two. This in turn is homotopic. So if I somehow apply it again, if I again write this as a composite of the identity, if I write this as a composite of the identity and this map, I can again make it homotopic to a quartet times pullback under four, to an eighth times pullback under eight, and so on. And so to, in general, to one over two to the n times pullback under two to the n. And the homotopy is witnessing this. The stay of bounded norm. Why is that? Okay, so what am I claiming here? So the identity on this complex is the same, is homotopic to the map, which pulls back under multiplication by two and then takes a half of it. Or pull back under four and then takes a fourth of it, which is some way to encode somehow that if you have maps of Abelian groups here, then, I mean, there's a Q vector space. So one way, this map is the same thing as first by multiplying by four here and then taking a fourth. Or first multiplying by 100 here and then taking hundreds here. Right. So, and the homotopies stay bounded because somehow also when you do the step, somehow you're also multiplying the homotopies by smaller and smaller things, and there's some kind of geometric series going on that converges. And so you can, in some sense, pass to the limit. And see. I mean, all maps 2 to the n are of norm s equal to 1, because if you pull back under this map, then, well, the pullback map from one compact Abelian group to another compact Abelian group to continuous functions can't increase a norm, can increase in supremum norm. So all these pullback norms are of norm less than 1. And so 1 over 2 to the n times 2 to the n is of norm at most 1 over 2 to the n. And so this means that it's homotopic to smaller and smaller maps. And so in the end, you somehow see that it's actually homotopic to 0. To the complex, I see. Yeah, so some of the ideas here is that it's a map of Abelian groups. So you can somehow first multiply and then divide again here. It gets the same map, but this will stay bounded here because it's after all constant, so compact, and so things can't get large. But then when you divide here, things get smaller again, and so this way you can make things small. And again, somehow compute something with a completely inexplicit resolution. All right. And I mean, somehow in a preparation for what Dustin will speak about, let me note the following corollaries that You can actually also compute. And now for a product of these, it is actually there, some of the. So this is not at all a compact Abelian group anymore. But fortunately, we are still able to compute arms out of this. And what did I want to say? Oh, yeah. So this is actually a situation where if you try to resolve this guy here explicitly, you would run into a lot of trouble because this is very, very, very far from like being a profinite set. I mean, it's a huge union of profinite things. And so if you were trying to build an explicit resolution in this case, you would be able to do it. It's just too big. And so we need to use some trick here. We have this short exact sequence. Zero maps to. Maps to crop. R maps to crop. I want to see. Where this here is some nice compact Abelian group. Well, this is still horrible. I mean, I don't know, that's not the kind of a real vector space that you would like to consider in functional analysis, just an infinite product of real numbers. But anyways, you can still do it. Note that, maybe I make this remark here. It's not really a warning sign, it's a comment. Infinite products are exact in condenser Abelian groups. So this is a property that usually always fails in topoi. Usually infinite products are never exact. Because somehow if you have a collection of subjections of between sheaves, then this just means that locally you can find, if you have a section, you can locally find the lift. But now if you have infinitely many such sheaves and take a product, then well, locally you can lift each of these sections, but if you want to lift all of them simultaneously, then you somehow need to refine all of these local covers, but usually you can't do that. You can't choose infinite refinements. But in condenser Abelian groups, somehow that's not an issue because you have these extremely disconnected sets with a variation on which commutes with anything. And so, yeah. This is one reason that we really want this very fine topology in condenser Abelian groups, that these infinite products stay exact. Okay, so we have this short exact sequence, and then we take the R-Horm like so, and so the R-Horm from the product of Hamad Z's into M is actually this direct sum over M's. So M here is discrete. I should say that. Give me minus one. And so if you look at the exact sequence, it's actually enough to show that the R-Horm from the reals, of the product of reals into M is equal to zero. So it's enough. It's the R-Horm in the product of R. this almost looks like something we already proved, namely we proved it for the real numbers themselves. And but this is an infinite product of the real numbers, so it's much, much bigger. And so actually the argument might work in this case, but actually there's a cheat even. Namely, this here is a module over the condensed string R. And so this has more module structures than this, and then actually somehow this automatically maps into any, in some sense, any element in here maps, gives you an R linear, or gives you a map from the real numbers into M. Or
Peter, don't you need the internal R-Horm statement for R in order to make this deduction?
Good point. I didn't yet talk about internal homes. I should maybe use, but yeah, sorry. Yes. Okay, so what happens here is that one way to rewrite this rather formally is as the internal home. So what am I doing here? I'm somehow, that's whenever you are in the situation where you're maybe in a topos or something, and you have maps from some module to some other module where this has some module over some bigger ring, you can somehow take the module set maps that are linear over this thing. And then we claim that this is actually already zero. And so then the whole thing is zero. So we need that the internal home but actually the theorem above on ULAs holds true. So internally. So the computation we've done actually works the same if you somehow try to compute the internal home in condensed beam groups.
What is ULAs?
Sorry, not ULAs. I'm always doing so much ULA things. That's the A's. holds true internally. So I mean the R home from the product. Let's see, is really a discrete guy. And also the R home from something compact to R zero. Oh, sorry, and also. Sorry, I'm writing on the wrong stuff. But anyway, it's also the R home from R to something discrete. So. And I mean, the proof is the same, except that. So what is the internal home? So the internal home from any A to B. See, if you want to compute the S-valued points where say S is extremely disconnected, then this is really just the R-home. I mean, just by the home tensor adjunction, it's the R-home from A tensor, Z adjoin S into B. And so what you have to do to prove this internally is you just have to carry through this tensor product with Z adjoin S through the whole proof. But this is actually not an issue because when you let's go a little bit on top. I mean, whenever you tensor this with some Z adjoin S here, then you can tensoring is exact. All the modules here are flat. And so it's just you get the Z adjoin R tensor Z adjoin S. But I said last time that this free thing is symmetric monoidal, so Z adjoin A tensor Z adjoin S is really just Z adjoin A times S. And so the only difference that you see is that somehow when you want to modify the proof, you really have to take care of this extra factor times S here. But then you just get the continuous function, so nothing much changes. And similarly here, when you want to do that, you somehow also have to take a product with S everywhere here. But again, this isomorphism is the same because it's still the same co-filtered limit here. And also here, if you take a product with S here everywhere, Still the same argument goes through. So all the computations we've done, they actually work internally. You just have to test on an auxiliary extremely disconnected set what these arms are. And so for this, you just need to tensor with the CJNS. And you actually look into the proof and see that all the arguments just work. Right, okay, so. I think that finishes this. Anything else I should say? I don't know. I mean, in principle, also time is up. So let's stop.
Okay, great. Thank you, Peter. Right. So